Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me.
That we'll be doing that'll take us through the middle of December, and we ask, Lord, that you would bless this study to us, that we would learn and glean from your word the many things that you have preserved for us, that we might know you better, we might walk in a better way with you. And Father, I just pray your blessing entirely upon us, and that we would leave here more encouraged and built up than when we came in. We're thankful, Lord, for the fellowship that we share with our brothers and sisters in you. And we ask that we might learn the lesson from tonight, which is that no matter the circumstances, that we can always be thankful and we can always seek to be faithful in living for you and to be an example for the world around us of what a Christian does and the hope that we have that comes only from you and your gospel. It's through your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Okay, so we have finished Sunday mornings, a study with the root of Jesse. We've been doing that from May all the way up to this past Sunday as we finished up the month of September. And we have also finished Wonderful Words of Life. That was our summer series that began the very last Wednesday of May and brought us through this past Wednesday, which was the last Wednesday of September. So where we were last fall was taking a look at the New Testament epistles, in particular Paul's letters. There are 13 of those, and we had taken a look at, starting from the order that they appear in our Bibles, starting from Romans and then moving on to 1st, 2nd Corinthians. Then we took a look at Galatians and then the prison epistles as they came up. And so in working on this study, well, first of all, there's a couple of different types of studies that we do. The thing that we had done with Root of Jesse and the Wonderful Words of Life was more of a topical kind of study. There's always exposition or exegetical teaching. You're always coming from the text, but it seems to be centered around more of a topically arranged kind of study. What we're doing here when we take on a book of the Bible is pure exposition. We're going through and understanding the context of when was the letter written, to who it was written, what were the circumstances under which it was written. We're understanding what are the issues that the church in Thessalonica is facing, and also taking each issue within the chapter as it comes through. And so you may end up being on a variety of topics depending on what Paul is dealing with as he gets into the letter. And so tonight, looking to introduce the letter to you and what's going on within the church at Thessalonica, and also jumping into chapter 1 as Paul is working through these things. I called this series of lessons the T's, and that's because we have 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, 1st and 2nd Timothy, and Titus. And so all those letters, all in order together, in our Bibles, all begin with T, and so that's what we're looking to do. And so Paul gets to Thessalonica for the very first time on his second missionary journey. If you remember, in his first missionary journey, Paul had gone through the interior of Asia Minor, or Galatia as it's called, and he had established churches there, and then eventually made his way back to Antioch. Judaizers, or those of the circumcision group, had begun to infiltrate the church, saying you've got to become good Jews before you can become Christians. And so this was an issue in the very early years of the century of the church. And so they sent Paul and Barnabas to Jerusalem to talk with leaders there about what's going on, what should we do. We have that wonderful letter that James helped them write in Acts chapter 15. And then they go back to Antioch, Paul and Barnabas do, and they decide at some point, let's take another journey. Let's go back to those churches and strengthen them And of course, they're not just going to go there. They want to go other places as well. And we're going to get into the beginning of that journey here in just a moment. But at some point, Paul, when he gets to Troas, right on the coast of Asia Minor, and you can see it on the map up here, he wants to go up into Asia. But the Holy Spirit keeps him from doing that. And he has a vision of the man from Macedonia that says, right? We've got all 13 letters right there together. But that's not the way that in which they were written. If you look up here, we've got the letters according to chronological order and the ways in which the years in which Paul would have written those letters mid-century. And so even though we covered Romans first and then 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians, that's how they appear in our Bible, that was before the summer series of 2023. So not this past summer, the summer before, we covered those three books and looked at what was going on in those particular issues that were going on then. The fourth book that we covered, we decided to back up and hit Galatians since that came next in our Bibles, but that was probably the first letter that Paul wrote. He was writing to the churches in Asia Minor that he had helped establish way back on his first missionary journey. And they were dealing with the issue of the Judaizers or the circumcision group that were coming in, really trying to add requirements to the gospel, that you have to become a good Jew first before you could obey the gospel. You had to follow the law, you had to become circumcised, you had to come into that old covenant before you could obey the gospel and come into the new covenant that God had made with his people through Jesus on the cross. From there, last fall, that was October 2023, through the rest of the year, we covered Paul's prison epistles. And so these letters were written at the very end of the book of Acts, when Paul is under house arrest and he's in Rome, and the very center of the Roman Empire, and he's there for 2 years in a rented house, and he's got a guard with him day and night. But God makes sure that people are free to come and go, and Paul is preaching the gospel, and those people are being baptized, and they're going out, and they are going back home to wherever they're from, because it's the center of the Roman Empire, and they're preaching the gospel, and people are obeying it. And so God was really using Paul in the midst of a very difficult situation for his good. And so he wrote to the Ephesians, first of all, and that's in Asia Minor. And then he writes to the Philippians, and that's way up in next to Thessalonica in Macedonia. And then he writes to the Colossians, which is back in Asia Minor. And then he writes a personal letter to a slave owner, Philemon, about the runaway slave Onesimus, who has become a brother in Christ and who is returning to his former master to be better than just a servant, but also a brother. And so that's a one-chapter letter. And so that's where we went out of order. Up until that point, we had hit 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and then we jumped to 13 because that was Philemon was part of the prison epistles that Paul had written. So what's left are the T's. And so we're going to take a look at the 8th and 9th books in our Bible that are Paul's letters. These happen to be probably the 2nd and 3rd letters that were written. Galatians was first. And then Paul would have written probably in the early 50s, right around 51 AD, a lot of scholars put this at, where he is writing to the church in Thessalonica, where he had been, where he had escaped with his life, and he's wondering how this church, in the face of great persecution, is really doing, and he's writing letters to them. After that, through the middle of December, we will cover what's called the pastoral letters. And these are letters that Paul writes to the evangelist Timothy and also Titus, two companions of Paul's, and we see them throughout the book of Acts showing up, and even in a lot of the introductions to letters, or in this case, as we look in 1 Thessalonians, we see Timothy has gone on Paul's behalf up to Thessalonica to check on the church, and then come back to Corinth, where Paul is, to report on what's going on. We see a lot of good things about Timothy and Titus. They're both in very difficult works, and Paul is writing personal letters to them to help them in their work as evangelists. And so we have those three pastoral letters about ministry. And so that's our plan of attack as we go through. Acts chapter 15, we're going to back up here a little bit and see where it is. They've just come back from their first missionary journey. They've gone to Jerusalem, back to Antioch. They spent some time in Antioch church. And now there's Paul and Barnabas are looking at each other and saying, I think we need to take another mission trip. It says, let us return and visit the brothers in every city where we proclaim the word of the Lord and see how they are. Now Barnabas wanted to take with them John called Mark. This is where we get the Gospel of Mark, but we also know from Colossians that John Mark was Barnabas's cousin. But Paul thought best not to take with them one who had withdrawn from them. And we know that was in Pamphylia on the first missionary journey. Before they had really gotten into Asia Minor, John Mark just said, he's probably young, and he just said, this is too much. And he backed away from the mission trip. And so Paul's like, you know, this is going to be hard, and I don't think he ought to go with us. And Barnabas says, no, we're taking him. And they had this sharp dispute and there's a disagreement so that they separated from each other. Barnabas took Mark and with him and sailed away to Cyprus. And so there's where we lose the thread of Barnabas a little bit. Acts is often called Acts of the Apostles and does follow mostly Peter, Philip, and Paul. But you got to imagine that all the Christians that were going forth with the gospel message, they had stories of their own that just didn't get recorded. And so Barnabas is one of those, that he's in the story for a while, as long as he crossed paths with Paul. But at this point, we don't really see Barnabas again in the narrative. But Paul chose Silas and departed, having been commended by the brothers to the grace of the Lord. And so on this map, you see that they go up through Lystra and Derbe area, and this is where they will encounter Timothy. Then they'll get up to Troas, and this is probably where they pick up Luke, because Luke, writing the book of Acts, we see the first we passage. It changes from they went here, they did this, to we did this. And so we believe Luke joined the narrative right here in Troas. And then they cross over, as I said, to Macedonia, and where they go to Philippi and then Thessalonica after that. And so you can kind of see there the progression in their second missionary journey to lead them to Thessalonica. Acts chapter 17 starts out by saying, now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews. See, Paul has a plan when he goes into town. He just doesn't go into town and says, well, I wonder where the local Walmart is, or I wonder where I could find a place to stay. Paul says, I've got the gospel message burning in my heart. I need somebody to preach it to. I'm going to go where people already have a knowledge of who God is, what he wants from them, because there's a law, there's a priesthood, there are sacrifices, there's a temple, and all of these things, and I could go there, and they're already looking forward to the Messiah or Christ to come, and so I can reveal to them that Jesus is the Christ, and this is a good place to start. He was an apostle to the Gentiles, yes, but they're a harder audience because they don't have any knowledge whatsoever, and he does convert quite a few of them as well. As the narrative continues, it says, and Paul went in, as was his custom. You see, Paul had a plan, always. His custom was to show up where people wanted to learn about God. And there he could reveal the Christ as Jesus to them. What is our custom? I said to the earlier class that I saw this Facebook meme that says, when I get up on a Sunday morning, I don't have to decide whether or not I'm going to church. I made that decision years ago when I was baptized. I made that decision, and nothing would change that for me because I knew what God had done for me, so I was going to worship him each and every first Lord's Day that I could. So as was his custom, we all have customs. We all have things that we're known for. Things that we can count on. I heard a story one time about an older gentleman who one Sunday morning, he had always been faithful, always attended church, and one Sunday morning he was not there. the entire church, it was a little country congregation, the entire church went out to his farm. And that Saturday, the day before, the tractor had rolled over and he was pinned underneath that tractor. He was alive. They were able to get him help, but it was because of his custom of always coming to church that when he didn't show up, they knew something was up. They had to check on him. And on three Sabbath days, so here's 3 weeks in a row, he reasoned with them from the scriptures, explaining and proving that it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead, and saying, "This Jesus, whom I proclaim to you, is the Christ." So think about how that was sitting with the Jews, because they're used to people showing up at the synagogue and talking about the coming Messiah, the one that was prophesied about, the one that Moses in the law would point to, and the things that they were they thought might be indications that God was going to bring him soon. And that wasn't what Paul was doing in the synagogue. Paul was proclaiming to them that that Messiah, the Savior that you've been looking forward to coming, has come, and it's Jesus. He went willingly to a cross, a Roman cross that they would all be familiar with, and there he laid down his life for your sins, and he overcame death, being raised from the grave, and only in him can we have new life. Amen. This is the Christ. How would this sit with those Jews? You know, you're coming into their place of worship, and you are proclaiming this new teaching that things that they've been looking forward to for centuries has now been fulfilled. It's going to set well with some. It's not going to set well with the others. Verse 4 says, "And some of them were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, as did a great many of the devout Greeks, and not a few of the leading women." So there's a good many who are obeying the gospel. But verse 5 says, some Jews were jealous, and taking some wicked men of the rabble, they formed a mob, set the city in an uproar, and attacked the house of Jason, seeking to bring them out to the crowd. And when they could not find them, they dragged Jason and some of the brothers before the city authorities, shouting, "These men who have turned the world upside down..." Wouldn't that be a great description for us if we were known in that particular way? That those Christians over there at 36th Street, or those Christians wherever it is that they meet, they're turning the world upside down by proclaiming that gospel, which means that their reputation must have preceded them. They seem to have some knowledge of Paul and his companions, even before he got into Macedonia, most likely. They knew that these guys, if they came to your town, they were going to turn the world upside down. You could imagine that as Paul stood up on that first Sabbath day of the three Sabbath days that he reasoned with them, that there must have been some who were a little anxious, saying, "I've heard about this guy. Let's see what he talks about, because I think I've heard about him." And maybe his buddy's like, "Well, I want to hear it out. I want to see what it's about. Well, I heard that he says that there was this man, Jesus, and he's the Messiah, and he got killed. Do you really believe he was raised from the dead?" You can imagine the talk that was going on. And then as Paul is proclaiming that Jesus is the Christ, that he fulfilled everything that the Jews had been expecting, that some of them are hanging on to his every word because it's bringing hope to them. And others are getting angrier and angrier with every word that comes out of his mouth. And Jason has received them, meaning that these guys, Paul and his companions, are staying at Jason's house. So they attacked the house of Jason. They were looking to bring him out to the crowd. They dragged Jason and some of the brothers before the city authorities. They're all acting against the decrees of Caesar, saying that there's another king, Jesus. What did the Jews care about following the Roman king? only when it's convenient for them to act against Paul and what he's preaching. They really had no love for the Roman Empire. But what they were taking the side of Caesar here because it could get them, it could get the world on their side against Paul. And the people and the city authorities were disturbed when they heard these things. Suddenly it's the jealous Jews and the city officials that are teaming up together against God. And when they had taken money as security from Jason and the rest, they let them go. Interesting that it's all about money, isn't it? As long as we get paid, we can let this riot die down. The brothers immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea. So Paul gets away. The Thessalonican Jews that were jealous are going to follow them all the way to Berea and cause trouble there. Paul is eventually going to escape there and get down to Athens and then Corinth. And it's from there he's going to be writing that very desperate letter to them, wondering how these recent converts to Christianity are doing in the face of great persecution. Those jealous Jews knew their names. Those jealous Jews knew where they lived. They had been part of the synagogue until Paul got there. But now they're trying to live faithfully to the gospel in the midst of great persecutions. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 starts out. Paul writes this letter. Keep in mind, he sent Timothy up. He's sent back a great report. And now Paul is writing to them to try to encourage them. Paul, Silvanus, the NIV uses the word Silas, and that's the one who went with Paul on the second missionary journey, and Timothy to the church of the Thessalonians, in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace. This is a normal way that Paul starts out his letters, wishing them grace, the abundance that God can give them, and peace, the absence of conflict, which would have been for the Thessalonians, Christians, something that was hard to come by. But that's what he wishes for them. We give thanks to God always for all of you, constantly mentioning you in our prayers, remembering before our God and Father your work of faith and labor of love and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. Faith, love, and hope. Have we ever heard those three put together before?
The word peace is an interesting study. Mm-hmm. It doesn't always mean the absence of conflict.
You're right. Peace doesn't always mean the absence of conflict. You're right.
Yeah. That's a good start to it, though. But there's more to it. The peace that God can bring that brings comfort and the rest. Galatians chapter 1, verse 3. Remember, that's the very first letter that Paul wrote. He starts out his letter to them in almost the same way. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Then a little bit later, at the very end of the book of Acts, when he's in house arrest in Rome, he starts out the letter to the Ephesians in almost the same way. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So we see a lot of similarity in Paul's style here and the things that he's wishing for these churches. Well, you can imagine what Paul is going through. Everywhere he goes, he makes Christians, and he's undergoing great personal suffering to himself, but he doesn't care about that. What he cares about is that these other Christians might be suffering to the point where they leave their faithful walk with Christ and drift back into the pagan culture from which they came from, or drift back into Judaism, which is a legal religion in the Roman Empire, and much easier to be a part of than being a part of Christianity. And he says in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, when he's recounting all the sufferings that he's had for the cause of Christ, he says, "And apart from other things, there's the daily pressure on me of my anxiety for all the churches." He's wondering how these Thessalonian Christians are doing. He knew how things were when he left town. He's gotten a good report from Timothy, but still he's wondering. And he will write to the Thessalonians in chapter 5 of his letter, in verse 18, "Give thanks in all circumstances." He knows what some of those circumstances are. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. That puts a little bit new meaning to it when you understand what's going on there. And then, of course, 1 Corinthians 13:13, here's that triad again of those three greatest gifts that God would allow to remain. He says, but so now faith, hope, and love abide, these three, but the greatest of these is love. So Paul will bring that back at least one more time to talk about faith, hope, and love all together. Verse 4, for we know, brothers, loved by God, that he has chosen you, because our gospel came to you not only in word, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and with full conviction. You know what kind of men we prove to be among you for your sake. Paul is relying on character here a little bit. He knows he didn't have a lot of time with them, but they had enough time with him to see the kind of man that he was, the kind of character that he had because he followed Christ. And so he appeals to several things. He says the gospel came to you not only in word. That's one way that the gospel comes to people, as they hear the word proclaimed, but also in power. There's probably some miracles. This was still early in that first century when God was using miracles through the Holy Spirit to confirm his word, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit with full conviction. You know what kind of men we prove to be among you for your sake. The gospel is also came to them because of the character of those who were proclaiming it. And I think we live in a very similar time to that first century pagan Europe, where it's going to be the character of Christians that is going to be noticed by people who are desperately looking for hope. We might not be able to proclaim to them freely the word of God like we should, but they will see how it is that we are living for Christ. And by our character, that might be at least the first foot in the door with some folks. Hebrews chapter 2 talks about this as well. It was declared, meaning the gospel, at first by the Lord, and it was attested to us by those who heard, while God also bore witness by signs and wonders and various miracles and by gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed according to his will. Hebrews chapter 12, it says, look at the character of those that you knew in Christ to be able to know what to do and how to follow him. This is, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. We always have the example of Jesus. But we have the example of faithful Christians around us as well, whose character has been proven, so we can follow that gospel as well. And you became imitators of us and of the Lord, Paul continues to the Thessalonians. For you received the word in much affliction. Yeah, there was a riot. Much affliction. You received it then. And you received it with the joy of the Holy Spirit, that even though you were going through those trials and difficulties, you had joy at that time from the gospel that you received, so that you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and in Achaia. In other words, sometimes the difficulties we go through, if we are faithfully living out our Christian walk, others will see and will become an example to them of how to live for Christ. I said in the afternoon class, I said, I don't know how many people, while Lori was sick and dying, came to me and said, I don't know how you're holding it together. I don't see how you can still have faith, but I can see that you do, and it's a deep faith. And their own walk was being helped by the example that I had. You became an example to all the believers. For not only has the word of the Lord sounded forth from you in Macedonia, northern Greece, and Achaia, southern Greece, but your faith in God has gone forth everywhere, so that we need not say anything. Can that be said about us as well? Do we too have that example of showing Christ to the world around us? 1 Peter 2, New Testament, tells us that we are to be that example. It says, "For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example so that you might follow in his steps." We're to be that example of Christ for the world around us. And so here we have a map. We can see Paul also going through many hardships that he did for the cause of the gospel. We can see on the map Macedonia up there in the north, and you can see Achaia down here in the south. Thessalonica is right where that star is, and down in Corinth, right there, is where Paul was writing the letter to them. But Paul, later on in the book of Acts, is all the way up here in Rome, and he is writing his prison epistles, having them go out to, you know, Philippi up here, and then Colossians, Ephesians, you know, to Philemon over here. But in Acts chapter 28, we can see the good that despite our circumstances, despite the afflictions that the Thessalonians had, they were able to become an example to the believers in Greece, north and south, but also everywhere, because of how they conducted themselves faithfully in the midst of great persecution, great pressure, to return back to the synagogue, to renounce this teaching that Paul and his companions breezed through town with, and just come on back to the synagogue and we'll just forget it all happened. Or if it was some of the Greeks or leading women, as it said, there in that Greek society, that they could just go back to their pagan idolatry. I'm sure commerce was very much connected to the pagan temples, as that was a good business of trade back and forth and everything. And now these Christians from both Jews and the Greeks are renouncing their place in society, leaving all for the cause of Christ, to say, "I'm going to follow Jesus," and all of my former co-workers, fellow tradesmen, all the people that would bring ships into port, they're like, "Well, I don't know, he's following something different now." And then you get to family and friends, and they've left all of that. And Paul finds out that they are living faithfully despite all of the afflictions, and that they are being good examples for Christ. And Paul does this himself. He's not just commending the church in Thessalonica. He's living it out in his own life himself. It says here at the very end of the book of Acts, he lived there 2 whole years at his own expense and welcomed all who came to him, proclaiming the kingdom of God and teaching about the Lord Jesus Christ with all boldness and without hindrance. God is able to use the afflictions that Paul went through himself to increase his kingdom, because Paul was willing to set aside his own needs for the kingdom of God. It continues, and we're almost done here with the chapter. "For they themselves report concerning us the kind of reception we had among you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come." What a great report that was. You could imagine the anxiety that Paul felt for all the churches, but especially for Thessalonica, not liking how it was that he had left town. If you remember, I think it was Damascus, when he was stoned and dragged out of the city, he stood up, dusted himself off, and went straight back in to preach. But in this case, the brothers kind of made him leave town, get out of there before things become really, really bad. Maybe it was even for the sake of the new Christians there in Thessalonica that Paul did stay away. But he had an anxiety for their situation, and he gets this great report that they are staying faithful to him. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 tells us, "For the love of Christ controls us." And we conclude this: "One has died for all, therefore all have died." We all die when we obey that gospel. "And he died for all, that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. That's what it's all about. There's the gospel message in a nutshell. And if we have truly died to our old lives, there is no going back when things get hard. We continue, we dig in deeper, we live for Christ and no longer leave him. So I'll leave you with this question. Are you an example to believers, no matter your circumstances? And I realize at this time that most everybody here, I think, has obeyed the gospel, and that's not something that maybe you need to do. Perhaps there's somebody here who hasn't. But there may be somebody here who has allowed the afflictions of life, the circumstances of life, to drag them down, and their walk with Christ is not what it should be. And maybe you need the help of your brothers and sisters, their encouragement, their prayers. This might be an opportunity to respond to an invitational message at this time as we stand and sing a song of invitation.
No tongue can bid me this depart. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me I